Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Everybody, and welcome to the February 20th meeting of the Alamance County Commissioners. Glad you could join us on this lovely day. If you would, please join me in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for all the wonderful weather you've given us today. And God, thank you for everything you've given us here in this country. We are so blessed. Father, be with this board tonight as we go through our business and our agenda and help us to make wise decisions for our county. And just be with us. These things we ask in your name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. All right. Next, we will have public speakers, and we have had two folks sign up. First, Penny Hawkins. You're first on the list, ma'am.
Nothing like going first, Eddie.
That's right.
Okay. All right. Good evening.
Good evening.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
My name's Penny Hawkins, and I've been a rider on the Part 4 bus route since pretty much the beginning. My fellow riders and I are here tonight to express our frustration and concern about the current overcrowded conditions on the bus and to express our support for funding to remedy the situation. As you already know from previous meetings with Scott, daily ridership on Route 4 has grown at an astonishing rate since 2015, and in fact, ridership increased by almost 167% from 2015 to 2016. It's now an almost daily occurrence. For there to be as few as 4 to 5 seats left by the time the bus gets to Mebane, which is the last stop before it heads to Chapel Hill, with sometimes as many as 20 people waiting in line. With so few seats available, the potential riders are either forced to depart the bus and drive to Chapel Hill to catch the park and ride, because you can't park on campus, or to stand. Neither of these options is desirable, and both present their own unique set of challenges. First of all, driving all the way to Chapel Hill to the park and ride lot clearly defeats the whole purpose behind public transportation. Public transportation is intended, at least in part, to reduce the number of cars on the road, fuel consumption, and emissions that are harmful to the environment. To be honest, if I have to drive 21 miles to Chapel Hill just to catch another bus and spend another 30 minutes before I get to my office, I'm just going to get a parking pass and join all the other commuters. And that's not what I want to do. The other option when there are no seats available is to stand, and in my opinion, this is an even worse option than having to drive. And I ask you, each of you, would you want your loved one to stand on a bus unrestrained at 65 miles an hour on I-40 for 21 miles? Probably not. The potential for a serious injury to riders is something that I don't think that can be overlooked. We've been very fortunate. We've had some really close calls on the bus. And because we've had experienced drivers, those things were averted. We've had some inexperienced drivers. In fact, there was an incident a couple months ago that my friend Terry and I looked at each other and said, thank God Miss Shirley wasn't driving, because it would have been a horrible accident. But so we were blessed. According to the UNC Office of Institutional Research and Assessment, as of fall of 2016, there are approximately 1,120 UNC employees living in Alamance County. I wasn't able to find any data on how many Alamance County residents work at UNC hospitals, but I would be willing to bet that it's probably a reciprocal number. Add to these figures the percentage of the 150,000 plus Alamance County residents who may, for whatever reason, like to take the bus to go to Chapel Hill for, you know, other reasons other than employment. I think it's pretty clear the real potential for growth on this route is, you know, indefinite for the future. However, crowded conditions can certainly inhibit future growth, ridership growth, and may even contribute to attrition over time. We've already seen a drop off in some of the regular riders that have been on the bus with me since the beginning, because, you know, if you know, literally, I get up at 4:45 in the morning. I'm at the bus stop at 6:20 to catch a 7:10 bus, because if you're not first in line, you probably won't get a seat. It's that bad. We understand that there's support for public transit within the county government, and it's our hope that you as commissioners will see that PART provides county residents with an immediate, inexpensive, and viable transportation solution. I have a petition here, which I'll give you in just a second, signed by Route 4 riders, which shows that we fully support Alamance County government participating with financial support for the operations of PART Route 4. Mr. Chairman, we're here tonight to ask that when the request for funding comes from PART, that you, as representatives of the county residents, are supportive as well. Thank you for your time and for consideration and for allowing me to speak.
All right. And you had those with you, the petitions. Yeah. That'll be fine if you want to have those.
You want me to give them to?
Here, just hang them here and I'll pass them.
And there's the data that I have on here.
Okay.
There's a copy for you as well.
All right. Very good. Thank you. All right. Next, we have Tony Cox.
I think it was last week I had said that the president had done a executive order saying that the president was giving the mentally ill their guns back over Obama's deal from going out, taking their guns away from the mentally ill. I actually seen on multiple news media, Congress, U.S. Congress, and Senate done a full bill that goes to the president's desk to where they passed the law giving the mentally ill their guns back in the United States of America. So, you know, the mentally ill need their guns. Seen out there, there's a good deal on Ace Speedway. According to the signs out there, there's three of them. There's a $25,000 reward for anybody that brings a buyer to a Speedway that is being asked $1 million. So I'd say that number come way on down there, especially after all the trouble that's been caused in people out there where they can't go to the racetrack and have fun. A lot of things could be done out there. You could do concerts out there. You could do bull riding, the trucks, the go-karts. That could be a good place. But hey, when people are threatening them people out there, and you heard it, threatening them people that are going out there to have fun, something is wrong. But hey, we got some radicals in this country. Downstairs, I appreciate going through that metal detector down there every time I come down here for a county commissioner's meeting. If I go to that courthouse, I look forward to going through that metal detector. But tonight, some people come through the door. Now, I was told by the officers at the metal detector that these are special county employees. When I got up here, I found out at least one is not a county employee. We have seen and heard of government people doing bad things to government people and citizens of this country. Let's make everybody come through those detectors down there. If I can be first, everybody else can follow. I'll follow everybody else. Have the same rules, the same regulations, and the same policies for all. Mental illness in this country is bad. I come down here in 2007. I said those people are lying. People said those people are lying. Not only did I say they were liars, from 2007 to this day, they've proven themselves liars who have done me harm, damages. And I'm ready to get off of this Ferris wheel. I'm ready to get off of it. Let's settle it up and go on. And hey, this is going on 10 years this year. I think I've used the honor and integrity of these meetings to prove my point. Thank you.
Thank you, Don. Any comments, commissioners?
I'd like to ask a question about your bus group, if you don't mind. How many of them are going to work versus doctor, or do you have any call on that?
just from observation, I think more than half are going to work. But we do, on certain days when they have clinics, there's more medical run people, and you can usually tell that they're the medical run people, wheelchairs and walkers and whatnot.
Thank you.
We're going to hear a report from
Scott Ryan
from PART, and he'll answer that question.
Okay. Very good.
I'm on the PART board, so I'm a little bit
you got a preliminary on it, right? All right, good. All right. Everybody okay with the agenda? I guess that's our next.
I move we approve the agenda.
Thank you, Bob. Thank you, Bill. All in favor?
Aye.
All right. And the consent agenda, is there anything on there that anyone would like to pull?
Yeah, it's going to be let's get B out of there if we can. Out-of-state travel.
Out-of-state travel, mm-hmm. Both of them, okay.
Yeah, both.
That'll be fine. We'll pull that. And just bring that into our regular meeting. Okay, with that pulled, any other amendments to it? If not, I'll entertain a motion to approve.
So moved.
Thank you, Bill.
Second.
Thank you, Amy. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All right, next order of business then is the out-of-state travel. And if Bruce is doing that, yes.
So we are requesting out-of-state travel for one of our employees, our tech that's assigned for locks and cameras. Last year, the sheriff bought a Panasonic system. It's a smart system, so it's got hard drives for backups and it allows a lot of growth. Moving forward, we will probably use the same system throughout the county as the other legacy systems go off, and it will save us money on maintenance and everything else. And so part of the savings of cost is they offer free training so that we can do a lot of the stuff in-house rather than have to call, you know, somebody on maintenance. But of course, we have to get them there. It's in Houston, Texas. So the total cost will be $1,453.58. I sent William to that training, if allowed.
Yeah, I apologize. I was just interested in the number two. I thought both.
Oh, well, I'm sorry. I didn't
mean to get Bruce.
When you said B, I
yeah.
just said
you,
okay.
You asked me for both, yeah.
Yeah, okay. All right, thank you, Bruce.
Thank you.
And we'll just vote on both at the same time.
Any questions on that?
I'm good. Thank you. And Ms. Brady, I suppose you're going to tell us about that one.
I am going to tell you about that. So you guys know that the Family Justice Center has been open since 2010. We've been a model for people in the state. And in fact, the Governor's Crime Commission has decided that this year, because it is a best practice model, that they have made a funding stream for Family Justice Centers from VOCA funds that are not taxpayer dollars. As part of that, they've approved for my team to travel to the Family Justice Center conference. So my team is completely turned over since I've been there, and no one's ever seen another Family Justice Center. But more importantly than that, a lot of the things have evolved over the years. So rather than being a crisis response, we're really trying to position ourselves so that we can respond later to people's immediate needs, but also their continuing needs. And if you look at our traffic, we do have a lot of people coming back for services. We are transforming ourselves into a trauma-informed agency, so there's a lot of things on the agenda for that. We're also focusing more on offender accountability, which is sort of new. So the Burlington Police Department is going down that road. We're doing a lot of things that drive people to the Family Justice Center because of our location. There are 80% of people that never come for services. And so we are putting together programs to identify those folks on the scene, connect them with someone at the Family Justice Center so they come. But as a result of that, we're seeing more severe cases. We're seeing people that are more traumatized. And so just over the years, you have to maintain that standard. People look to us throughout the state to be a model. They come to the Family Justice Center. We get calls from everywhere to come. And we want to be able to continue to meet the needs the way we should and can as a community.
Now, what was your comment about not tax-paid dollars?
It is not. It's VOCA funds are fines that are levied on businesses that, for whatever reason, have committed a wrongdoing.
It's 100% paid by the Victims of Crime Act funds.
Okay. So tax dollars, whether it be federal, state, or local, aren't going to that.
No, okay.
That's all I wanted to know.
That's right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
No.
I think it's great what you're doing, and after seeing what happened in Mevin with that situation, I mean, that if we can avert one of those situations.
That's right.
Somebody.
And I'd just like to say that we need to support our staff so that they have the tools necessary to do their jobs. Mm-hmm. And I think both of these definitely fall into that. And even if it were taxpayer dollars.
All right.
Well, it depends on the excess. Let me comment about that. You have how many people going to this conference?
Nine
people. If tax dollars were paying for all of those, I would say send three, and I don't believe.
Come bring it back.
Yeah, bring it back, whatever. I mean, that's my only point. I mean, this,
Point well taken.
Yeah, thank you.
I'd like to make a motion that we approve both of these.
All right. Thank you, Bob.
A second.
Thank you, Amy. All in favor?
Aye.
Very good. All right. Next, we're going to have Scott Ryan with PART come and talk to us a little bit.
Very good. Thank you, Commissioner. My name is Scott Ryan. I'm Executive Director with Piedmont Authority for Regional Transportation. I want to thank you for the opportunity to come and share with you a few things with our organization. Also answer some questions that you have. Commissioner Sutton, answer your question. We're about a 75-25 split, with regards 75% being work-related, 25% being medical, and those medical trips that we have are basically coordinated up through your DSS and your local county system, ACTIV, who essentially bring their clients to the bus, put them on the bus, we take them to Chapel Hill because that's one of our stops, freeze up their vehicle to stay and do their local service, and also is just a cost-saving element that had Commissioner Boswell, how much time do I have on your agenda?
Well, try to keep it in 10
minutes. I will try to keep it as quick as possible. Yes, sir, I will. Presentation that I've already been here with you. Also, there's some information I have as far as some packets that are in front of you. Some things in your packets are just a little bit more history with regards to this particular route. And I guess the only thing that I would ask for you all is if you see something, please stop me and ask. Otherwise, I will go through things that I deal with every single day. And unless I know that, what is he talking about? Please just let me know so I can put it in neutral a little bit and really maximize the best use of your time. Real quick, and I'll go through just a little bit. I won't go through all of these things in great detail, but essentially the PART agency was created under state legislation. We received our articles of incorporation in 1997. And you can see some board members. I'd also like to recognize Mayor Lenny Williams, who is on the PART board, has been for a number of years, over a decade now, that's been serving on the PART board. Mayor Williams represents, he serves as chair of the Burlington Graham MPO, Metropolitan Planning Organization, which is one of our founding members. You can see the image up to your right-hand side. That is our original five counties, four cities, four MPOs, two airports from 1998. And Alamance County was a founding member of the PART organization, which also was signed under resolution from each of our affected counties and city jurisdictions for how we received our articles of incorporation. We have grown since that time, but essentially as of today and since 2007, we had 10 counties that are within the PART territorial jurisdiction. We still have our four largest cities, which represents Burlington, Greensboro, High Point, Winston-Salem, our four metropolitan planning organizations, which also includes Burlington Graham, High Point, Greensboro, Winston-Salem, our two airports, which is Smith-Reynolds, as well as Piedmont Triad International, and our other board membership includes NCDOT, Division 7, Division 9, as well as a member on the multimodal committee for NCDOT. So all that being said, I have 21 board members and quite a few things that I have to answer to and fill in those questions that we do with our business. PART staff, I have 24 staff members. And we focus on specifically these areas with regards to Part Express, community resources, which I'll touch on a little bit, our regional planning activities, which also deals with things related to air quality, as well as our travel demand model, which gets into highway planning, as well as some things we have with regards to administration, marketing, federal compliances, all those things that we deal with in our business. Community resources, in a snapshot, it is business-related mobility, and it is essentially dealing with our van pooling, car pooling, working directly with businesses with regards to mobility options. This is just a snapshot of our van pool map, and you can see from our entire coverage, we essentially have 54 van pools that are in operation. This really represents anywhere between 7 to 12 folks in a van. They're primarily with businesses or university systems here in Alamance County. You can see that I have one van that is operating internal within the county, and I have 5 vehicles that are originating and then going out of the county. And I also have vans that are coming from Mount Airy going down to Charlotte. They're all over the state. So that in and of itself is the first program that PART, the regional authority, took on for our region that was dating back to 2000. And continues to grow, but essentially, again, it's working directly with businesses, directly with mobility, and some of the other programs that we have for folks that share a ride for their place of business. Regional planning, specifically, we go into some things with our city and counties with regards to transportation planning. We deal a great deal with regards to travel demand modeling, working with NCDOT, that's on the highway side. With regards to how our highway projects get into the state transportation improvement program, how do those projects get formulated and analyzed as far as volume and capacity, and I won't get into all the algorithms and all those things dealing with that, but that is a part of what we deal with regards to planning, because we work with our 4 MPOs, our counties and our cities, and if we're dealing with transportation, it is multimodal, and that's also what we deal with regards to our agency, is multimodal usage for different types of travel. Yeah, and a lot of our activities are dealing with regional planning. PART Express, you've already heard from one of our customers, and I know you've got some other things, and this is an item that we have brought up. This is an item that we need to discuss, and I won't say that this has been brought up for Commissioner Lashley or Sutton or even Commissioner Gailey, but I have been here before with some of our other commissioners. This is our system map. This is the territory that we cover. The PART agency first started operating buses in September 2002, and we have grown since then. Now, we are a regional system, which essentially is in place to connect our urban systems, as well as our rural communities to our urban core, what we would classify as our urban core, which is our job centers. So, if we want to go in and go into those details about where our jobs, where our growth, all these things are connected in that fashion. But essentially, when we started in 2002, we were connecting specifically High Point, Greensboro, and Winston-Salem with their urban systems. And from that time, we have grown to other areas, which also includes Alamance County. This is a snapshot of what you've already heard. But essentially what we have been dealing with, what's been brought to us for almost a year now with regards to Route 4. This is our Alamance Chapel Hill route, and this is essentially our daily activity, which you've already had some comments, and yes, we receive these comments from our customers as well, which I could say is, you know, mostly complaints, but it's a comment. It's a good situation for us to be in if we want to talk about how are you judged with regards to your service. That's ridership. We're at that point with regards to this route. Ridership is more than what we can handle with regards to capacity, and we need to address that, and that's why I'm here, because we do need to address that. So this is essentially what we deal with our customers. They are pretty much on a daily basis looking for what is the best way for them to get a seat. Otherwise, they're either going to stand or they're going to ride, take their own car, and then deal with how they're going to get back and forth to their workplace. And if we have time, there is a video. This is a 3-minute video.
We're okay with that.
Yeah. And go down to the one. If
uploads.
After which one?
The uploaded video. Just press uploads where it says uploads the word. Sorry.
I see videos.
Yeah, that would be good.
Uploads.
Yeah.
Which one?
Right there. It says, you see the young lady that has a meow hat.
Yeah, who rides the bus. There you go.
It's just a 3-minute video. This was last fall. It is onboard survey.
A lot of people that I knew were riding park bus. I didn't realize it until I, you know, really got on the bus.
I was a little leery of riding a bus because I'd never done that before, but it's been a good experience.
I've been riding park for about, I think, about 7 years.
I've been riding since the route started.
I have no transportation, and the express gets me to and from where I need to be.
It's free for UNC employees. You can't beat that.
Number one, I don't like driving to Chapel Hill. Number two, it's cheap.
Of course, naturally, I can't ride, but I do have a ride from my house in High Point to here, so this works out good.
Fares are reasonable. Yeah, buses are usually on time, and they go to the places I need to go.
I ride Park Express to save wear and tear on my car, save gasoline, save the cost of fuel. I estimated I probably saved about 30,000 miles over the past 4 to 5 years.
They have a nice discount for students, so that's pretty good.
With the environment, you know, it helps reduce carbon gases. And
it's very easy to use. It's not difficult. They get you there on time. And
staff is friendly. You don't worry about any, like, the seats being dirty or the floor being dirty.
I mean, the prices are good. The driver's always courteous.
It's very relaxing. The seats are very good. And it's a lot of fun because we all laugh, we all get along.
They have nice people there and you have fun on the bus.
Just being able to sit there and not have to worry about traffic and not having to just deal with the stress of commuting back and forth every day.
It's the people, the conversations, and I like not having to worry about the traffic.
I think there should be more buses going from here to other locations, because this one is often full.
Some people have to stand, so I believe that can be really improved.
I would love for the service to extend the hours during the day and evening, and Saturday and Sunday routes. That would be very helpful for a whole lot of us.
I probably speak for other people that feel the same way, just if we could have more bus routes and more frequencies.
One thing, thank goodness for it, you know, because you get a chance to save money, you know, for those that don't have a lot of money.
I would say with how fast North Carolina has been growing, that I think public transportation is going to become more and more important.
Thanks so much. I can't find a single complaint. It's been good for me for over 5 years now.
Thank you. Okay. Is this this issue with regards to our service? This is not just Alamance County, but this is something that we have for a number of years and going on a decade that is something we have to address. And when I say it's not just Alamance County, we have other services for our entire system that we are looking into. And here we are on February 20th, and we are all dealing and looking ahead with regards to our upcoming budgets and what are we going to be doing with all of our public services. And we have this at the PART agency as well. So we have services that are operating in Surrey and Yakin and Davie and Alamance, all our entire network, to try to address some of these items that we know where we can actually do more to actually have higher ridership, more usage, and that gets into extended hours as well as Saturday services. And those are the things that we're looking at. Now, with that, that kind of gets back into how are you going to address these comments and questions that you're receiving from Alamance County? And that essentially comes down to one dreadful discussion, but it's something that we need to address or come up with some types of solution, and that is the financial impacts. And I'll go through those, and I'll be more than happy to answer any questions that we have. Our existing service, you can see that's on the left-hand side. On the right-hand side is what we're trying to do with regards to Route 4, as well as some of our other heavier used routes. And again, how are we measured? How are we judged within our industry? It comes down to fare box recovery, comes down to ridership, and essentially how are you utilizing taxpayer dollars for the public service that you provide. So each one of our services that we are looking to expand are on that upper end of success stories. And when I say success stories, it is not a service that is subsidized and does not have usage. So it is essentially trying to make more of those services available because people have already shown that they want to use it, and now we have to address that deficiency of not enough there for people. This is what you can see with regards to Route 4. You can see essentially where we were on the blue line. We made some route modifications and changes with regards to our services, our stops. We have some additional park and rides that we've included here in Alamance County. And you can see where that increase in ridership has gone with regards to our service. And in within this time, we're still dealing with the same route frequency configuration of our system. And that route, there's a route brochure in your packet, but it still is getting to that point of people are standing, people are not getting on the bus because there's no more room. How are you going to fix that problem? This is just some demographics with regards to our routes. You can just see there with regards to our overall with Alamance County. I will say that the majority of our ridership, percentage of our ridership of Alamance County residents is at 74%. We have some folks that live in Mebane, and we don't know if they recognize themselves as being Alamance County or Orange County, but that's essentially folks who are living in Mebane. We also have folks that are coming from Greensboro, which is our beginning point of our route, and we have some folks that are also coming from Gibsonville, which could be either Alamance or Guilford County. So we have some that is right there on the county line that we not necessarily being able to address where do you live. And that's a difficult thing for us to also do. Where do you live? Every time we have people on the board boarding the bus,
Scott,
because we don't answer those questions. Yes, sir.
Those Gibsonville and Mebane, those aren't included in the 74%?
Those would be the ones outside of what we can recognize as Alamance County residents.
Well, I know, but when you said it's serving 74% of the riders are Alamance County,
That would not include those.
Not areas. Including those. Okay.
Yes, sir. Some capital investments that we have with regards to this route actually goes back to the American Recovery Reinvestment Act of 2010. That's when we established our Graham lot, which is right down the street on Highway 87, utilizing some federal funds. That was essentially 100% federal funding under the American Recovery and Reinvestment Act. We have also just this past May have opened up a park and ride facility at Alamance Regional Medical Center. I had some federal grant funds. Local participation came from Cone Health. We also had some funds that came from NCDOT. So that was my 100% package of building that facility. We have a park and ride facility in Mebane that is also at Cone Health at their facility right up the road from the Tanger Outlets. We have a lease agreement with the city of Mebane, and we are cost sharing that annual lease with Go Triangle. And so essentially we have been very creative over the years of how to keep things going and allow it to build. Our operating investments, this is just a snapshot of the funding participation that we receive and different times that we have with regards to our services and each one of these counties operating on these different corridors. And so you can see majority of what we're dealing with is you drive a vehicle, which essentially is a rental car revenue tax, but we also have available some other funding options to support our system and our services that we provide. Our funding options based on our legislation that we have available, of course, is what I already mentioned with regards to the rental vehicle fee. We also have vehicle registration in $1 increments between $1 and $8. We also have an option with regards to a voter referendum at a quarter cent sales tax referendum, which would essentially be up to the voters to vote. Now, each one of these options, of course, the park board, which is a governing body, a governing unit of government, cannot impose any of those fees or taxes, whichever way you like to say it, without first the consenting authority of the affected county. So the park board essentially, and has already, we essentially established a tax district, and they are the governing unit that actually is imposing the fees. But before we are, before the park board is able to do that, they first must receive consent from the affected county. And that ties back into our state legislation with regards to our revenue sources. So where are we at this point, where we're at with regards to our service? We need to address this issue. We need to address this issue with regards to how are we going to expand service, because the question is always coming up to me, how are you going to expand service? And honestly, I can no longer take local funds that have been supporting this service from other counties for a service that is expanded here locally now in this county. That's a very difficult discussion, but that's that is exactly where we're at with regards to leveraging our federal funds, utilizing our state funds, all of the grants that we have that we deal with on an annual basis, which we have grants for operating, capital, all of these things that go into our industry and our business, still has a local match. Everything that we have, very fortunate to hear of your other comment where you have 100% paid for something else. We're not in that position with regards to transportation dollars. There is usually a local match, whether it's 50% for operating or it's 20% for capital. Federal funds, state funds are still local match. And we need to expand, but we also need to figure out how we're going to come up with a local match to expand that service. So that was real quick. I can go back through it again. I'll leave that up to you. I'll put up some other videos, but I'll be more than happy to answer any questions that you may have.
Do we have a dollar that would be generated by the various means of?
I think last time when we looked at it, probably about 4 years ago, we looked at the 5%. It was raising anywhere between $50,000 and $70,000.
Correct.
On the rental.
On the car rental. We have not done a look at the vehicle option.
I think you're about 100. I think you got for the $1. I think you have. And I can give you the exact number. It's I want to say we're right at 165 vehicles that are registered for Alamance County, give or take a few, but we're right
probably
going to
be real close either way on that.
$165,000.
Yes, for $1. That's correct.
If we were to contribute to PART, can you reassure us that we're not going to be approached by somebody from Chapel Hill, Durham, from another transportation authority, saying that since Alamance County citizens are going to Chapel Hill or going to Durham, that we need to contribute there too?
That's a good question. I can tell you two things. First, I can say that I wouldn't be a bit surprised if somebody came and asked you for it. But from the other standpoint, there is no other legislation that is available for these other systems to receive funds from Alamance County, unless it came from general funds. That's totally different. But if we're talking specifically with regards to the rental car, voter referendum, or vehicle registration fee, we are the only agency that the county could consent that authority to, because Alamance County is a membership of the regional authority part under Article 27. Our sister agency to the east, which is Go Triangle, which had voter referendums, and they, if they ever come ask you for money, I want to know, because they have every single source of funds available to them that's in place and active.
So they're doing things like vehicle registration fee and
they are they have had vehicle they have yes for quite a long time for Orange and Durham as well as Wake County. They have the vehicle rental fee that's been in place since 1997 for each of those. They also have maximized the $8 vehicle registration dollars for each of those counties. This past November, Wake County approved the voters in Wake County approved the half-cent sales referendum, and then in 2014, Orange and Durham voters approved that half-cent voter referendum. So they have lots of big plans, fixed skyway, rail systems, absolutely, but their legislation does not allow them to have funding from a jurisdiction that's already a member of our regional authority, so they'd have to expand their territory.
So you're pretty well protected, that's basically.
Well, you're protected.
We're protected,
or we are.
We're trying to work to see how we can protect each other, though. You're right.
It was mentioned in the video that your prices are good. What are your prices for ridership?
We have different fare structures. The one-way fare, if you were just to board the bus and pay out of your pocket, is $2.40. And there is no transfers, but anytime that you're boarding the bus, you can pay $2.40. If you're in a rural area, this is another item that we're going to be bringing up, why you have rural and urban. But we do have a one-way fare for our rural routes, which essentially includes this route, Route 4. Also includes our Surrey, Yakin, and Davie, those areas outside. Those are $3 one way. But then we also have a regional, a monthly pass. So we have a 10-ride, and then we have a monthly pass. And if you're by that monthly pass, it's essentially a reduced rate. And yes, monthly pass is $90, which is unlimited rides. And for somebody that rides the bus every single day, then that would account to much less than three, or much less than $2.40, because it's a $90 a month pass.
For many I have a friend that actually works at Durham at Duke, and they pay his ridership.
Yes.
And he's 25 a year he has to pay, but they pay for him to
That's correct.
Come back and forth every
UNC
day.
UNC does that too, right?
That's correct. That's correct. And that's also related to how our ridership has increased, is because we've actually implemented some accommodations with UNC, not only for the university but the medical folks, because they have parking issues. And if you've ever been there, you know exactly what I'm talking about. So they subsidize their employees, and essentially they also have some of our other businesses that utilize our vanpool program. They can utilize a commuter tax benefit. And so we work with all those folks to make it come together. But that doesn't take care of everything. And yes, have I maximized everything I can that's feasibly and even allowable with regards to federal funds, state funds? And we have. And that's why essentially we're here, because we need to expand more. We've already shown and seen that we have a lot of folks that need more, but we need to address that deficit in order for us to actually say, here's your next route. And how are we going to make that solid with regards to
Greensboro on Market Street, right at the airport, you're building a new, is that a terminal?
Yes, sir, it is.
Howard Coble terminal.
All right. Are you closing the one that is on 68?
Yes, sir. We will. Yes. Hopefully by July 1, if I can get through some construction things, but those are just dealing with construction.
It concerns me a little bit that we're here talking about money flow and money that you'd like for us to give you, yet we're seeing none of your finances in this packet. I mean, is that not possible to show us that?
It absolutely is. Would you like to see it now?
If you got it, yeah. You know, I'd like to see a printed copy if I could have one, a hard copy.
I can give that to you as well.
Okay, thank you.
Because it's all open records, and we're government just like every other government, so it's at any request. And yes, I can tell you with regards to your individual system, as well as how does that compare with our other systems and how we deal with our budgets. And I think that would be very easily for you to see, because when we deal with our budgets, just like you have with your own budgets, we have our budgets for our entire program, but essentially our budget related to Part Express is actually broken up into 14, 15 different categories. And what does that essentially mean? That all goes with federal funding, state funding, local funding. So I have Route 1 budget, Route 2, Route 3, all the way up through the entire system, because everything has to balance. And this also goes back to why are we having some of these discussions, because it was essentially the Part Board's direction that we have to address this. You get out what you put in. Now, the service that we've been operating here in Alamance County actually dates back to 2004. But we are at that point now of dealing with expansion to where we can no longer take money from other areas and bring it in here, because those other areas are also dealing with growth. But as far as the budgets, I'd be more than happy to share those with you, because we deal with those and have them in place. And those all deal with a lot more with regards to how do we report, how you deal with National Transit Database reporting and things, which is much more time than what y'all want to hear about. But it's compliance and regulations, and we have all those things spending Uncle Sam's money, as well as state dollars. Any other questions?
I just like to comment that public transportation is very important in our society, because we keep growing. We keep adding more population
And we have to provide other options. You can't just expect or force everybody to drive their own vehicle because there's not enough space on the highways for everybody to be driving a vehicle. So this helps to get vehicles off the road. It helps deal with the parking issues that are everywhere. And this is why the federal government passed
they
a huge,
that.
Yeah, they recognize it, and they passed a huge transportation bill this past year. And that provides the funding for the parks of the world.
Yes.
And other Wink Transit and ACTA and
Correct.
Because all these transportation entities are pretty much grant funded. Except
for
but to leverage those state and local or state and federal dollars to come into this community,
we've got to
provide some matching money. And that's kind of what comes out.
And that's the dilemma. That is really the dilemma that we have. And it's it provides growth, but we actually have to be able to show that we have something local to where we can leverage those other funds. And they are very competitive. Don't get me wrong, because it's not just us here in North Carolina. We have many urban systems and many rural systems. So we have to be in a better position to where if there, that opportunity exists, whether it's federal or state funds, and I go after what I do to go bring those dollars back home, the thing that holds me back is, where's your local dollars? I don't have it. Well, we're moving on. Come back and see us next time.
Get passed up.
And that's tough. That's tough because if you're not necessarily in the game competing with everybody else, then you're always going to be at a loss, and that's what we're trying to get away from. So, Mr. Chairman, I know you've had different things in your local paper about asking for the funds. I'm not here asking for the funds, but you're dealing with your budgets, and I'm dealing with my budgets for the upcoming year, and I do need to come back and get the consent or get the denial, whichever way, but I do need to formally ask that, but I will follow up and give you some information.
Will your financial statement show what the other counties are dumping in? Whatever mechanism they're using, will it show the numbers Randolph's putting in or the other counties, the dollars?
Their contribution part.
Yeah, Randolph County.
Their contribution to
yeah.
it.
Yeah.
Yes, it is. It does. And I can tell you Randolph County is the one county I will say that is stable, always has been most stable because it is a $1 vehicle registration fee. So it's $145,000 what we get from Randolph
County.
See,
my point is, and I'm not new to this, I mean, I was here when Brent McKinney came here.
Yes.
Okay, and, you know, I think if it's going to be addressed, it needs to be, in my opinion, addressed from the budget process we have as to whether or not we want to give a certain amount of money or not. The logic doesn't flow with me that you would tax or fee a rental car agency. Now, I don't know if you're familiar with this or not, but when Brent was here,
I invited. 17 years.
Were you here? Okay.
Yep.
I invited
your rental car agency.
The rental car agency to come in and
yes.
be represented. Well, we were sitting up here getting ready to do something and not even invite them in, which I found to be atrocious. But, you know, and I asked Brent that night, and I'm serious about this. You know, I said, can you give me a logical flow here as to why you would take money from them or to tax their customers or to fee their customers? You know, can you give me a logical, can you tell me why that should be allowed?
That's
and
tough.
Do you remember his answer?
No.
Well, I do. He looked at me, grimaced, where you're standing. He looked down at the podium. He looked up at me, and he shook his head no. He couldn't give me a logical reason as to why it was being allowed, short of that it was being allowed by the state law, and y'all were willing to take the money. I have a problem with the per-car fee because I don't see, you know, why they should be charged with something that they're not causing the problem for, in my opinion. You know, I think if anything, it should be addressed in a budget process as to whether we want to give $50,000, $30,000, $20,000, or nothing, rather than, you know, fee people that aren't related to it at all, as is, I don't think the rental car agencies are. And again, I think on the car fee, you're able to go up to $5, if I'm not mistaken. I mean,
$8.
Okay, it used to be $5.
That's yes, correct.
So they've raised that even higher.
That's correct.
So, you know, where does it stop? So, but again, I appreciate you being here. But I would like to see the finances of your operation.
Yep. And the only thing I would go ahead.
Well, I would just like to offer a different way of thinking about that. The legislature has allowed municipalities and authorities such as park
state legislature
to have these other
yep.
Fees and I think it would
we wouldn't be doing right by our taxpayers to take it out of property taxes when these other fees are available or taxes are available. Mm-hmm. From the rental car perspective, most people who rent a car are renting it because of they've damaged their car,
the insurance
is going to pay for it. Or there are people from out of town who are attending a conference and yep. their employer is going to pay for it. Now, I know it's all going to be paid for by society as a whole. But I would hate to have something available to us by the legislature that's not out of our general fund, which really impacts property tax.
Well, and not to belabor the point, but you asked the question of the logic. Those are fund sources that were generated by the General Assembly, and I don't know how much logic I can give you a response to what they do with down there. And well, I really can't. But it is there, and it's been in place for years. Now, the one thing I would also share, and I'll send this to you also, the question with regards to the rental car agencies, because I think this is very important. What's the impact on that? As we've come out of the recession, there has not been a decline in those revenues. So I can share with you what those revenues are and the impacts associated with the rental car collections that we receive, which is predominantly from the other counties that are participating. So that 5% that's been put onto rental cars, or whether it's dealerships or enterprise, if there was an impact, then you would have anticipated or you would have seen some decline. But everything has been growth as we've come out of our nation's recession. But I can share that with you as well. Yeah. Be more than happy to.
All right. Thank you very much, Scott.
Thank you for
and
your
we
time.
Will get
Thank
this
you.
On our agenda pretty soon.
Very
I think.
Good. And I'll follow up and give you some other information.
Thank you for
yes.
coming.
Well, thank you. I appreciate your time.
All right.
Sir. Thank you.
Thanks. Very good. All right. Next, Jeremy Atkins. He's hanging out in the back room. You haven't sent those rebound notices, have you, Jeremy?
Not yet, but I'm about to.
Okay.
I'm very close. Thank you for having me tonight.
Yes,
matter of fact, our notices go out March 1st, so we're almost there. And this is a great time to do some housekeeping. The Board of Equalization is created by the Board of Commissioners to stand instead of the Board of Commissioners to hear appeals. I don't know exactly when ours was created. I've got documents back to 93, so I know it exists of then. I've had some people say that they remember board before then. I've had others say that was the first board. I don't know. But it's very common with a revaluation to go through the board resolution and make any housekeeping refinements or anything like that. And that's what I bring before you today. In your packet, you should have the proposed changes. And I've got two copies. One copy highlights exactly what was changed. The three major things that I would like to change for this revaluation cycle going forward, the first is the board terms. So the Board of Equalization are on 3-year rotating terms that in no way correspond to the terms of the Board of County Commissioners. This makes it very difficult to keep up with because Board of Equalization members expire midterm of County Commissioners. County Commissioners come in, but the board member that represents them has not yet expired. This makes no sense to me. And so the cleanup would make it match directly. When you come into office, you appoint a Board of Equalization member. If you're reelected, you reappoint. Just makes it very straightforward and clean. Another change is through the years, we've gone back and forth between the Board of Equalization appointing their own officers, their own chair and vice chair, and that function belonging to the County Commissioners. Right now, the practice of our board is that they appoint their own. And the paper says that this board appoints for them. And so I would like the two to match. And it makes the most sense to me to let the Board of Equalization sort that out themselves. So this revision would simply say that they do what they've been doing. The third change that I want to highlight, the Department of Revenue and the School of Government offers training for Board of Equalization members. Now, right now, folks that serve on the Board of Equalization have had their training either from the tax administrator or from pre-existing board members who got it from the tax administrator or pre-existing members from the tax administrator. So I think there's a conflict of interest if one of the parties that they're hearing a dispute between is also the person that's supposed to tell them what their duties are, what their powers are, what their limitations are. That just seems like a conflict. I don't really care whether it's School of Government or the Department of Revenue, that both offer courses. It will be a half-day course. We'd fully fund everything relating to that. But what I request is, with each cycle of being appointed to the Board of Equalization, that they just take that four-hour course. And now the conflict of interest is gone, because I'm not telling the board what they can and can't do. Department of Revenue or School of Government is their contact. What I'm seeking tonight is just that the board resolution that is in place be amended according to the version that's in your packets. Any questions?
I thought they sounded good.
I thought so too. I think it's a good idea.
Thank you.
I think that's fine.
I'll make a motion. I'll second.
Thank you, Bill. Thank you, Bob. All in favor?
Aye. Jeremy, may I ask you a question?
Somebody called me the other day. I don't know who it was, and I don't know where. I think you were involved talking about 8-year recycles versus reevaluations versus four.
Right.
And, I don't know the gist of the conversation other than I think you were possibly in favor of 4 years. Mm-hmm. Okay. And from what I was being told, and we had this come up a couple years ago, when Bill and I were here. Isn't there about 10 counties still left that do 8-year cycles?
I don't know the exact count. I know that I would actually think it's more than 10 counties left, but I don't know.
Yeah, I'd like to know that if we could do it. We did a survey on it. Mm-hmm. It was like 10 or 12. You remember that?
There's the great majority now. I think it's fair to say the great majority do a 4-year reval. So I would say 75%. I'm guessing that.
That's a decent guess.
Yeah. I'd like to know who they are that still do they.
Absolutely.
I imagine it's about the cost.
Huh?
Yeah. Well, cost.
If you got 4 years, you got about $1 million up there for 4 years.
Once
every 8 years.
That's the real challenge.
Yeah.
Is obviously if you do it twice as frequently, you spend twice as much.
That's right.
Now, it's easier, and this came up at the last town hall meeting. By the way, town hall meeting tomorrow, 7 o'clock, Mevin Library. At the last meeting, that question was raised. The Department of Revenue is pushing really hard for counties to get onto a 4-year cycle. It's totally voluntary. There's no force behind it. The question is, would I prefer one? Of course I would. But that's not a Jeremy Aikens question. That's a Board of Commissioners question, because you're talking about doubling your cost because you're doing it twice as frequently. I would say from my perspective operationally, it's a lot easier because you never have to outsource anything. You can keep your staff and just keep the rolling.
Going on.
I think your quality control, your accountability is better. I think we can do a better job. But is it worth twice as much as we spend now? And that's really not my place.
And the greatest thing for the 4-year is you don't get the jump in valuations that you do on 8, because we really got hit bad because when the last reval came out, we went to the bottom of the market, and when the revaluations were done the year before, near the top of the market, that's where you get 18,000 appeals.
Wow.
Your appeal process should be much, much, much less doing on a 4-year. Much better and truer valuations moving forward, especially if you're supposed to be at 100% evaluation.
Right. Well, and I've talked to my counterparts in other counties at classes and conferences, and without doubt, if you hear a county complaining about a difficult revaluation, they're an 8-year county. Mm-hmm. The 4-year counties are like, oh, I remember those days.
Yeah.
And so, from my perspective, I would love to see us go to a 4-year. I'll be very honest and transparent about that, but it will cost more, and that's why it's not my decision. That's the board
call. Well, some people on the most negative comment that I can make about going to 4 versus 8 is some people believe, and I believe there's some validity here, is that it gives government a chance, boards of directors and so forth, a chance to play the revenue neutral game more twice rather than once, and if you know what I'm talking about. And but I would like to know how many counties don't do.
I can get a count.
Or that do still have the 8 years versus.
I
think
you'll
find out it's about 11 or 12, somewhere in that range.
Okay.
Yeah, I might be wrong with that.
So how many appointments you going to have coming up? Three?
We got three coming up.
Three coming up, okay. Mm-hmm.
So we're reformulating the board with three appointments.
And that board is going to pick their chairman.
Mm-hmm.
Is that correct?
Exactly. And that's the practice.
I think that's a good idea.
Yeah.
Yep.
I prefer to let them sort it out,
but
it's interesting. It used to be in compliance with the resolution, then the resolution changed, but the practice never did.
Yeah.
So,
Before Jeremy sits down, I'd like to let everybody know that I have a constituent who had a concern or a question about his the amount of tax that was paid to the state for one of his vehicles. And I forget what the exact issue was. I did know, but I forgot for now. But
the Stewart.
Uh-huh. Yeah. And he showed me the correspondence. This was a question that didn't have an easy answer, and
right.
You,
Jeremy, tracked it
really
right
tracked it down
state,
and spent hours, and then explaining what you had found in a way a very complex
it
issue.
It sounded
in a way
like
that
something
really
needed to be corrected across
oh,
the
absolutely
state.
Absolutely.
On vehicle.
I say kudos well to you for the
you. I
for taking
that
care of this
I
mean, gentleman's
yeah
concern.
Thank you.
Yeah, I've heard that same thing.
Oh, thank you. I
doing
appreciate
a good
that
job.
All right. Very good. I guess we need to vote on this.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, okay.
Oh, my God. Well,
it's already
been
moved and seconded.
Yeah, okay, well, it's been a while.
Okay.
Excuse me. All right, all in favor?
Aye.
Thank you. All right. All right, next, Craig, if you'll bring us up to date on the
I will. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. In discussions with the superintendent, Dr. Bill Harrison, after our joint meeting, it was probably time to say we need to get that facilities task force back together. And if the board remembers, it was made up of two board members, staff, and also three members from the general public.
Right.
And since we've had the new election, and now I believe Vice Chairman Lashley will serve on as the board rep, Commissioner Sutton will serve as that board rep. We sent an email out to our citizen reps, who were John Paisley, Albert Freeman, and Sammy Mosier, asked them if they were still interested, that they needed to contact the board or contact us. We've not heard from them. So we need to begin looking at appointing three citizens to this board, and I do believe you have two applications in front of you who are interested in this. And if agreeable, we need probably get a time, a couple of dates that we can get with ABSS to begin the facilitating the facilities committee again and start meeting again. So they are really interested in pushing forward with having these discussions further.
Any comments, guys? Girls?
Nope.
Well, I suggested Betsy Honeycutt.
No relation.
One of those three. No relation.
No relation.
The name, last name is spelled differently.
Yeah, that's right. She spells it wrong.
I've known Betsy for about 3 years. I met her through her husband when he and I were participating as dancers for the Pink Ribbon Luncheon fundraising event for the Charitable Foundation at the hospital. I won't say about what we wore, but there were tutus. but every time I've encountered Betsy, she has just been very passionate about the Alamance Burlington school system. She has a child at Hillcrest, a child at Turntime, and I saw her at one of the public forums that they had on the redistricting issue, and she's the kind of person that has just the very highest integrity and is not afraid to speak up. And I think just having that parent's perspective would be a really good idea.
Well, my appointee is similar to that. So if you call me fussing about something, you might be get put on a board. Because we had contact last week, and I said, you know, you really need to voice your thing out here where the school can hear it also. And so I said, you know, we have an appointment for that board. Would you be willing? So when you call fussing, be careful. You might get a board put on the board. Her name is Bridget Yeager, and she is has children at Williams High School and also is a booster member there. And so I think she'll be a good voice on that task force.
So there's room for one more if we do
these
two?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yep. You need a motion for those two? So moved.
Second.
Thank you, Bill. Thank you, Bob. All in favor?
Aye.
And so we do have one more, and why have you both here? Are there times that are not good for you? Is it mornings, work, or certain days of the week that I can get back with the school system so we can try to get a couple scheduled?
Tim used to work in.
What, for meetings?
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I'm in Greensboro every day at 3 o'clock, so.
So in the morning?
It has to be in the morning, so.
9:30? 8:30?
Nine.
I know you. You wanna get 7:30? Nine, okay, so mornings at 9.
I thought you was an early riser.
Hardly.
So mornings at 9 is what I will get with the school system, so we'll start the facilities. And we're good anytime mornings after 9.
Yeah.
Okay, we'll try to get you some dates for that. We'll try to get you some dates.
Very good.
Thank you.
Thank y'all for stepping up too, guys. All right, next we have Stacy with the with a budget amendment or two.
Good evening. I believe the first one you all have is the dental budget amendment.
Yes, that is correct.
So what you have before you is a dental budget amendment to add $1,500 in grant funds to the dental budget. This money was awarded by the Delta Dental Foundation. This is the third year that we've gotten that foundation money. And we use that money to purchase tools and supplies to allow us to reach the children that we serve in the clinic. And this is foundation money and no county or local matches required.
Sounds good. I'll make a motion that we accept that.
Second.
Thank you, Bob. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
And next.
The second one you have is for environmental health section in the amount of $3,000 by the United States Food and Drug Administration. This is a grant for training for our environmental health specialists who are in the food inspection program with our health department. And this program, this training is for the adoption of the standards for the voluntary food retail program. No local matches required for this one either.
I'll make the motion. We accept that.
A second.
Thank you, Amy. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Stacy. All right. Next, we have the county manager report. No, cooperative extension.
Yeah, we have one more.
Skip right over Mark there. I don't know how I missed him.
Mr. Chair, if I may.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
So I'm going to follow along with Scott's theme on transportation. And so we've got a transportation issue with our 4-H group. So due to the efforts of Taylor Jones, our 4-H agent, and Lauren Langley, our livestock agent, our 4-H group is growing. And they participate in a lot of activities. And so what we want to do is take $15,000 of our performance money, and we can match that with $15,000 of 4-H money. So they've been saving money for over 20 years from plant sales, donations, memorials, that we can put this money together in order to buy a van. So right now they're very limited in the activities that they can do because we don't have a van. So we can use a recreation parks van on occasion, but that's only in county. And so a lot of these clinics and contests and things they go to are out of county. We've got a couple of our kids here now that are in the 4-H livestock judging group. They have been in the top five in the state. I think last year, 2016, the junior team was the state 4-H livestock quiz bowl champions. So these are kids that are in 9 to 13 years old, so we're going to have these for a while, and we want to encourage their participation in all of these activities, so we're requesting approval of our funds so we can get a van and keep them winning.
Sounds like a great idea. Actually, I got a little letter from one of the 4-H'ers.
I did too.
In regards.
I mean, that is so unusual to get a letter to start with.
Yeah, everybody on right there.
Aiden Kernodle, is it?
Yeah. Right.
Yes,
Aiden.
All right.
I received one too. I was going to read mine if that's okay.
I think that'd be great.
I'm a member of the Alamance County 4-H program. I'm asking you to vote for 4-H to get a van. We have lots of programs that involve traveling places that we need a van for. I really like the summer classes and the fun places we get to go. I would be sad if these were gone because we don't have a van. So I would make a motion that we approve that spending request.
I'll second that.
Thank you, Amy. Thank you, Bill. And I, too, am very excited that we can do this. All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you.
And can I say that to Aiden? Aiden, I actually wrote you a response, and you probably won't get it till tomorrow. Cause I think,
he got it tonight, actually.
I think
yes, right.
I think mine was from Miss Kernodle, Akia Kernodle.
My daughter, she's got the flu. She would have been here tonight.
Oh, bless her heart. I hope she feels better.
Awesome. Your letter to me was well-written, well-reasoned. But my answer back to you in my reply may not make any sense. I said I was going to forward it to Mark. Mr. Daniel here and our county manager to put it in, to see if they'd put it in the budget. So I didn't, because I wrote it before I saw that it was on tonight's agenda. So
very good.
But you got
all right.
You need.
Thank you for doing that. Very nice. All right. Now we'll have our county manager report.
First, I'd like to let me turn over to Clyde real quick to discuss some timber issues.
You know, you call last year. We entertained placing a bid for clear cutting timber on the landfill property.
Mm-hmm.
We estimated it would be about $98,000 less than it came in. It actually came in at $372,266. Troy, a lumber company, and Mr. Henson here was responsible for advertising for the bid. If the board approves this, you can either accept it or reject it, but if you approve it, we're prepared to go ahead and prepare the contract and the timber deed, and they'll have 2 years to clear this. It'll be a clear cut, and then we will replant.
How big a area are you talking about for $300,000?
It's a 403-acre parcel, but actually he's going to clear cut 124 plus or minus acres on that property. We're going to take the logging road, and we're going to use that logging road for our new access to our scales that we're planning to put in.
Yeah.
So we can have a state-of-the-art recycle center, and we'll have two entrances to our landfill.
Okay.
This will add quite a bit of money to our landfill budget, $372,000. If we plant, reseed, we'll be able to, in the next, 10 years, 15 years, we can cut pulpwood off.
16.
It was 2010 that we went in and pruned this property.
Yeah.
And they got about $100,000 for that. So it's being managed real well. And I'd ask the board to approve this bid from Troy Lumber Company, a pretty reputable company, to
you think that's a good
property.
Price?
Well, according to our appraisal it's $98,000 more than he valued it at. So.
Well, we can put it out for bid again? What do you think?
Well,
we have a push for time.
I think you've got an appraisal that came in at 200 and what was the 60. Appraisal?
200.
We did an appraisal and established a minimum acceptable bid at $276,000.
Right.
I think $30,000 higher.
98,000.
372.
Okay.
372.
I think it's a pretty good bid.
Okay.
Yeah, I think we're good on that.
Okay.
And I would ask for a motion to accept it.
Thank you, Bill.
Second.
Thank you, Amy. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you, David, for your work there, too.
Yes, sir.
Mr. Chairman, I do have just a couple of things. I wanted to mention that County Government 101 starts on March 7th at 5:30. And, Tori, how many weeks do we have that? Is it 10?
Nine.
9 weeks. So it'll be every week for 9 weeks, beginning at 5:30. So we, 6 weeks, I'm sorry.
No,
okay.
6 o'clock.
6 o'clock. How do I have 5:30? I don't know. 6 o'clock on March 7th. And, but again, county government, you can apply online. We encourage people to do that. Is really set up like the Sheriff's Academy, and we go through a lot of different things of what we do in county government. So I hope we can get the word out on that. I appreciate the work Tori has done on that. Just a couple things I do want to mention. There's been a couple of funerals that we've had this week. If the board is remember, Lieutenant Chris Schaffner, who was a lieutenant in the Sheriff's Department, passed away recently, and his funeral was on February 10th. Please keep his family in your prayers and your thoughts. And for a personal note, I do want to mention the passing of Harry Jones. Harry was kind of one of my heroes in the manager's profession. Harry was the manager of Mecklenburg County for 12 years, the first African-American manager, and just an incredible guy, but he passed away with pancreatic cancer, and his funeral was today, and it was a very, Harry's just a great guy. So I just wanted to mention him publicly in the record how important Harry was. So thank you. That's all.
All right. With that said, go ahead.
I'd like to do something before
everybody
leaves.
That'd be fine.
When Amy and I were at the last school board work session, there's a presentation to the school board by some of the faculty at North Graham Elementary School. All the students at North Graham are going to be involved in a production of The Lion King.
Oh, okay.
And they didn't know that Amy and I would be there representing the commissioner, so they brought tickets for the school board, but they really wanted to extend the invitation to the board of commissioners. And this is integrated education. This is, North Graham Elementary is an A-plus school, which means it's focused on the arts. And in the production of The Lion King, they're going to be utilizing math skills because they're making their own costumes. They're doing all their own staging. And so they're bringing in all the subjects to put this production on. It's not just music and acting. So
that's our invite.
This is your ticket, and you can bring somebody else with you. But you need, if you're going to go at all, you just need to respond to Tara Raggett. Her email there to let her know, and then she'll make sure you have a front row seat. It's March 1st and 2nd, and it's at 5 o'clock.
Right?
You got your name's on.
Okay.
Here's Eddie.
Thank you, sir.
And here's Amy's. She sent these to me in the mail, and I told her I would pass them out. So
thank you.
Bill Ashley and Tim Sutton.
All right. Thank very
let
good.
Let me ask
thank
you a question,
you,
Bob. You're big in music, right?
Yes, sir.
You know, I tell kids I drive, I said, you know, I'm so old that I bought a record that was a theme song for a movie that you saw quite often. They said, what? The Lion King. Do you remember who did the original? Well, it was in the movie. The original song was in the movie The Lion King. You remember the song? What's the a wimba wacka wimba wacka wimba wacka song, whatever that is. The Tokens did it.
The Tokens.
And that was the first record I ever bought. I probably was about 9 years old when I bought it.
See, I grew up listening to the big band era of music, which is way before that. So.
Yeah.
But that was the wimba wacka song, whatever that is.
I feel like I need to put in a plug for Van Halen right now. That's my generation, right?
All right, before we get too far out of hand, I want to make a motion.
Well, I hate
here.
To ask.
I'd like to make a motion that we go into closed session pursuant to North Carolina General Statute Section 143-318.11a(3) in order to preserve the attorney-client privilege between the county attorney and the board and receive a report regarding the claims made in the cases entitled Manning versus Alamance County, Randleman versus Alamance County Sheriff, and Holeman versus Alamance County. And I need a second on that.
Second.
Thank you, Bill. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Who played Benny Goodman in the Benny Goodman movie? If you want to go back to the big bands, Steve Allen.
I'd like to make a motion that we go back into open session.
I'll second it.
Thank you, Bob. And our discussion was to give our attorney instructions on the three cases. And if you have questions, ask him to the meeting. All right. Only thing we got left is commissioner comments. Do we have any?
I just have one little question. We had discussed our draft rules that we were talking about. I was wondering if we have an update on that.
Almost. Getting close.
Okay.
I'll have one for you probably this week.
Great. Thank you.
What's the draft rules?
The draft rules to look at.
Yeah. With the comments.
I was wondering that too.
Yeah. Very good.
Thank you.
All right. Anything else that we need to discuss? Not, close.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers at the County Office Building at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Typically, the first meeting of the month is at 9 a.m. and the second meeting of the month is at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. The video of this meeting is broadcast on Time Warner's Public Access Channel on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month at 10 p.m. You can also access this meeting through our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information about watching meetings online. For technical questions regarding this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions regarding the content of commissioners' meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says County Commissioners to learn more about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about the county commissioners. You can send mail correspondence to the commissioners by sending it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.